everyone, and welcome back to Spill the Tea. I am your host, Kiera Benson.
And I'm your co-host, Nicole Patch.
And today we are going to be talking about Felician University and the history of it. Apparently, National College Colors Day is September 4th, so make sure to wear your college colors, especially if you're here at Felician Fest. And on top of that, we have a very special guest of us today. But before I get into introducing her, we would like to remind you to go on Facebook and look up Radio Felician. And you can also call us at 201-340-4374. I'm going to repeat that number one more time, 201-340-4374. And also make sure to go check out our Instagram, Felician Spill the Tea 123. Now, today, our special guest is Sister Annelle. Welcome to Spill the Tea. We are so honored to have you with us today. So can you give us a little information about how you got involved with Felician?
Yes. I was just talking with Jeff here. And just to give you some preliminary before we talk about the beginnings of the university, I was a student here. I got my bachelor's degree in elementary education from Felician.
Oh, wow.
And then I came in 1972 as an instructor in the teacher education program, teaching the reading courses, preparing teachers at that time. So, and I spent 22 years here at that time. Then went on to do other things and came back 6 years ago.
Wow, that's amazing. So you have a lot of like history with Felician, it seems like. That's amazing though. That's great. What do you love most about being a part of the Felician family?
You know what? I've always felt comfortable. Somebody asked, I like that you asked me that, Kiera, because somebody asked me what it felt like coming back after so many years of being away. Yeah. And I said, it felt like coming home. Okay. I have always been comfortable at in Felician. And I think that's why, if you notice, so many of our staff and faculty spend many years here. Yeah. It's certainly not the money thing. You can go somewhere else and probably get a better salary. But they just love and like working with the people.
That's so awesome that you said that. And I feel like as a student, we feel that, you know, from the staff. Like everybody is very caring, very involved. And because I came from Bergen Community College, and I felt that way there also. But here I feel like it's so family oriented, you know?
Yes.
I completely agree with that. That's one of the main reasons I chose Felician, because I can distinctly remember going to like the open houses and just everybody was so welcoming and so kind. And I remember I went to a couple open houses for Felician, and I remember at one of them, I actually got really overwhelmed and was like kind of crying. And I was upset because I was like, oh, like college is so like stressful, like making a decision. And I remember Erica, who's in charge of, you know, all the student activities and clubs and stuff. She pulled me aside and told, like, you know, gave me an entire speech about how, you know, you should follow your heart and do what you want. And just hearing that from her saying to me, like, you know, just like Felician might not be the school for you, you don't know. Like just hearing that made me feel, wow, this is like a really like kind and caring place, you know?
You know, one of my favorite memories of when I was a student, I was just at the time beginning of my religious life, as a matter of fact, and the president of the university at that time was Sister Justicia, and she used to, I guess she loved when we would get our grades at the end of each semester, those of us who were sisters, she would bring us into a room and actually, you know, give us a little pep talk and say something about, she'd call us up to get our results of our from the semester. And she called me, and in one course, I didn't get a very good mark. And she said to me, this doesn't seem possible since you got a mark, you got marks like this and this and the other areas, what happened? So I really just said to her, I really don't know, Sister Justicia. Well, you know, she actually went, she looked up that prof. His name was Mr. McKinney, I can still remember. And he taught the history courses. And he said, she went to him to find out what happened. And he said, let me take a look at her final paper again. And he looked at it and realized he never really corrected it. He was probably called away or something, and therefore put a grade on it that didn't really belong to me. And when he reread it, went back to Sister Justicia and said, I have made a terrible mistake here with this sister. But how many presidents of a college or university would do something like that for a student?
Wow, that's very true. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. I love that. I love how involved the president was with the students. That's amazing.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow. All right, so I think we should get into some, you know, facts about Felician and the history of it. Do you have anything you wanted to share first that's off the top of your mind?
Yeah, I can go. You know what? I took the time to really look up some of this stuff again. And I, you know, it's amazing that in 1923 was when it really began as Immaculate Conception Normal School. Now, they used to call colleges who were preparing and training teachers normal schools. Okay, that was way back in 1923. By 1935, they reached the status actually of a teacher training college. And you know who they affiliated themselves with? This was amazing to me. The Catholic University of America, that's in Washington, D.C.
Wow.
Okay, and what happened then, because it was only around, I guess, 70 something credits you would get at that time, so not enough for a bachelor's degree. So then what the students would do, and they were all sisters, nobody else, it was only open to sisters at that time.
Wow.
Then they would transfer either to the Catholic University of America or Seton Hall here in Orange or Fordham in New York to finish the degree and then claim a bachelor's degree. Isn't that really interesting that it goes all the way back to the 20s and 30s?
That is, wow. And how you would have to move to a different school after that. That's very interesting.
Yeah, and I think, let me see, when was it around? It was recognized as a junior college by 41, but you know, often when you look at when the university was established, they'll use the year 1942. And it was then that it really became Immaculate Conception Junior College. That would basically be compared today, I believe, to a community college, you know, how they say Burton Community College,
right,
et cetera, yeah, right? So, you know, it, when you think about it going all the way back there, it's, they didn't, you know, I said it was only sisters, not only the sisters from my own order, you know, we're Felician sisters or Franciscan order, but any order of sisters could send their community members here. But it was, this is, I think, an interesting thing too, that I do remember in 1964, okay, that's when they first accepted lay women.
Wow.
So at that time, you only, you know, it was only open then to lay women and the sisters. I didn't look up the date, but another interesting feature, because I was here already, when we were going to accept the first male, and he happened to be in the nursing program. But do you know who was most against us becoming, rather accepting male students? Take a guess.
I have no idea. Nicole, any guesses?
I don't know.
No. Board of trustees.
Wow.
The guys on the board of trustees. The guys on the board of trustees.
I wonder, I guess maybe they just wanted to keep it for women.
Yeah, and then, you know, it probably got to the time when financially that they had to open it up to men and women.
Right.
There was a time here, as a matter of fact, I was already here and I would have been the dean of education by that time. We were dropping in enrollment so badly that we had plan A and plan B. And if we were going to close, I mean, I was working on where could I transfer the education majors if we had to close?
Wow.
And then at that time, we found a very interesting sister. I know her name was Austin. She was not from our community. And she came in as the registrar. And boom, she just had the personality and everything. And we, well, you see, we exist yet.
Wow.
Can you believe that? I mean, you know, when I was thinking about this stuff ever since you invited me and looking up some things, I was really remembering everything. Here's another, you know, that little red building that is by the quad on the Lodi campus.
I'm so curious to know what that is.
I know this story. I want to hear it again, though. I love this.
One, it's the only original building left from the Hennessy property, which we purchased, Felician Sisters purchased. It has been so many things, but what I remember, I, as a student, took an art course in there.
Oh, wow.
But it's been many things. As a matter of fact, when I first came to the university in 1972, Sister Justicia, the president, asked me to be the den mother over there. I had, I think, 7 students who lived there with me.
Wow.
And when we were going to, when we built the college, okay, the Obel and the library, we moved the river.
Oh.
The river ran along the side of what we called Founders Hall. Okay. It ran along the side that would be facing Obel.
Oh.
And so think about how we moved that.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And you know why it was crazy? I remember when we flooded a few times, they said a body of water will always seek its original bed. So you see, it, that's why it always comes, if you notice, it comes toward us.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not away from us. It's always toward us because it's seeking its original bed.
Wow, that's so interesting. That's pretty
cool. You learn something new every day.
Yeah. You know why I laugh? This is funny. I had this tiny little room on the first floor, right? And, you know, I had those Luger doors, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They didn't even close. It didn't even close properly.
Uh-huh.
And I had a bunch of nursing students in there, right? And I'd get this knock on my door sometimes in the morning. Not so much from the nursing, now that I think of it. We had a medical laboratory technology 2-year program at that time. So they would come knocking at my door. Sister, did you go to the bathroom yet? We need a specimen. Would you believe? They also wanted to try taking my blood, but I couldn't go that far.
Oh my goodness.
I chickened out for that. But I, you know what? That's where I really found how much I loved interacting with students. I formed the front of the building. When you walked in, we had a sitting room there, like with some couches and chairs and TV. And sometimes I would just sit there with the students, and like one, I can remember a nursing student said to me, she had her English paper and she said, "My paper is hemorrhaging," which meant she had a lot of red corrections on it.
Oh my goodness.
So, yeah. Like, obviously that building is not in use now. When was the last time, I guess it was it, that people were actually in there and they were using it?
Well, let me go back. As I said, it was many things. It was, when I first came in 72, it was a dorm. And then I don't remember the years that we closed the dorm up. So what they basically did, because I was back, I was here then, they put it up for, and Sister Hiltrude, I believe, was then the president, to any department in the university to make a case for why they should have the rights to that building, right? So being the dean of education at the time, I remember us writing up the fact that we were the first four-year program approved by the state of New Jersey, the teacher education. So we claimed that we were the first four-year program and that the entire teacher ed faculty could fit in it. And we got it. Wow. But then it became the Teacher Education Center.
Oh, wow.
And I think, and I'm going to say this because I left around then, I had to do other things. When they moved the teacher education program and faculty to Kirby at the time, okay, I think that was the, they were the last group in there. I heard that they're going to take it down. And I would presume it may not be in such, you know, we're talking years now since it's been closed.
Yeah.
So I would say that, you know, it's probably not in very good condition right now. But as I say, because I know I asked the question, did it have any type of historic value to it? Was it listed anywhere? And they basically said no. So you couldn't make the case to preserve it under that. But it'll be a building that I know will affect the sisters very much so when they see that coming down. Because, you know, years ago, what I remember, we used to have like these picnics and everything down there. Mm-hmm. Because think, you did not have the university, Obel. You didn't have the library. That was all ground with the river running through it. And we used to sell ice cream from the first floor of that building during the times people would come, you know, I forget what they called those things, but you know, you could play games where they spun the wheel and everything and win different prizes.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I forget what you call those things.
Oh, I don't know if it has a name or not. I can't think of the
name. But you know, it was during the summer. And we would sell ice cream from there and like cold drinks.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, I've always been curious what it looks like inside that building. Like now, like I know it's been sitting there for years, but I've always wanted to go inside it and see what it looks like, you know.
Yeah, me too. That's why I asked. I was so curious.
Well, when you walked in, there was, as I said, that nice little sitting living room like. Then there was a small hallway. I had a room on one side. There was a student on the other side. And when you came out of our rooms, you made a little left-hand turn, and there was a small kitchen where the students could make something for themselves to eat. We had an oven, a refrigerator, everything. Then there was a bathroom on that floor with a shower. And at that point, if you went to the right, it was like a room that you could use in the summer, but it didn't really have heat to go out there in the wintertime. And if you turned to the left, you went up the stairs. And again, you turned to the left again, there was a larger bathroom with a tub, okay? And then there were 1, 2, 3, we're about probably 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rooms. And then the part that faces the parking lot was a very big room where I think almost 3 students were.
Wow.
Oh.
So that's what it basically looked like. When we took it on as the teacher education, we left the downstairs as it was, except on one side. I said I had the room that I slept in became the secretary's room. And then when you went up to all the other rooms, the faculty used them as offices. And my office was in that big place that faced the parking lot. It was a very comfortable, I mean, I enjoyed the students there. And as I said, I had maybe 1 or 2 ed, I had more nursing, and then I had at least 1 or 2 in the medical laboratory technology. We became like a little family.
That's so awesome.
I love that. Wow. Mm-hmm. I think that's so interesting. I feel like a lot of students on campus now currently don't really know about the history of that little red building on the Lodi campus. So I definitely feel that this was a great thing to talk about today with the history, you know?
Yeah. And I feel like even, you know, the history of the college alone, like it's so important. I feel like if more students hear this, they'll get so much more connected to the university and, you know, maybe why they had chose it and, you know, how special it is, you know, and to take advantage of the resources that are here and the people that you can find out more information from.
Yeah, well, we're thinking about doing something. We had a meeting today. We called it a mission meeting with Dr. McGeary, who is, besides being the interim president right now and the vice president for academics, and she's also the mission effectiveness person. And she was talking to Andy, who's the campus minister, Father Tom, who's the new campus chaplain, Ingrid Dull, who is taking my place as the director of Blessed Mary Angela Institute, and me. I'm going to be working now in campus ministry. I'll be very honest with you. I turned 78 this year.
Oh my goodness.
God bless you.
And I decided I'd come down to part-time.
Yeah.
And I love working with students, as I said. And we started to talk, you know, in October, we always celebrate Heritage Week.
Yeah.
And the theme is going to be this year, Reclaiming the Vision.
Oh.
And what we talked about today was exactly what you just mentioned now. We were talking about when we were going to associate it with an appreciation of the environment once again. You know, how we should take care of Mother Earth.
Right.
And we were thinking about, wouldn't it be wonderful to just walk around the Lodi campus and even engage some of the sisters in talking about the different buildings. Don't you think that would be a good idea?
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, and we even thought, you know, somebody like Dr. Dolores Henchy, she's been here a very long time. She would so well be able to tell us about when we moved to Kirby Hall. And Kirby Hall is part of the oldest building. It was the provincial house for the Felician sisters here. And when we moved out of that part of the high school was there. When I first came to the high school in 1956, would you believe it? Okay, I came to the high school. We had classes there the first year. The high school wasn't built yet.
Wow.
All right. So we thought, wouldn't it be nice if we took tours? We took people in small groups, you know, paying attention to the COVID requirements and everything. But we thought that would be so interesting to people.
Definitely.
Yeah. Oh, good. I'm glad you agree. I can tell the group we're meeting again. I could say, let me tell you, I know some people who agree with it already.
We're on your side, okay? Okay.
You know, if you also go to Felician's website, they actually have a tab where you can see facts about Felician if you guys want to learn more about Felician as a whole. It actually says on there, and I didn't know this, that the castle on the Rutherford campus is 145 years old and is listed as in the National Register of Historical Places. Wow.
So awesome.
Yeah. That's why, you know, when they're building this new, what do they call it? The WARC, WARC.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's why the people in the town were very concerned, right down to the fact of were trees blocking the castle.
Mm. Wow. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, because the castle is like, I feel like when you think of Felician, I feel like the first thing I think of is the castle, like, because the castle is so amazing and so beautiful and so historic as well, you know?
Was it used for like other purposes or?
It was the home of the people who owned that property originally, I believe.
Oh, okay.
And then Fairleigh Dickinson University was there. And Fairleigh left.
Right.
And then we purchased it.
Oh, wow. That is so awesome.
Yeah.
I wonder, do we know what year Fairleigh Dickinson left?
Yeah, I have it here somewhere. Oh, I got it here. 1997 is when we purchased it.
Wow.
Wow.
The Rutherford campus is technically still newer. So I would say that still.
Yes. I mean, when you think we're starting 1923 and it's 1997 when we're purchasing the property.
Wow.
Yeah.
We were on Lodi first, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
That's the original. And you know what I thought was interesting? I got to say this. In 2006, WRFC was the student-run internet-based radio station established.
Oh, my gosh.
I knew I wanted to get that in somewhere.
Yes.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
I think it's just amazing how much Felician has expanded from, you know, all the way back in, you know, like when they first, 1923, when it first was Immaculate Conception, and how it, like, how much it's expanded to now, you know?
Yeah. I mean, just getting the university status in 2015.
Yeah.
I know the rule. Are we up time? No.
We're good.
What I thought of is, I know to claim university status, one of the first things you have to have is a doctoral program. And I think you have to have the first graduating class before you can appeal to the state to be named a university.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I also wanted to share some other facts about Felician for, you know, non-Felician students who are looking to maybe come to college here. You know, a good thing about Felician is that the student to faculty ratio is 13-1. So, you know, you're not just a number here at Felician, while at somewhere like William Patterson or, you know, other places like bigger schools, you know, you're not in a small classroom setting. At least here at Felician, you can be one-on-one with the instructor. And, you know, the percentage of classes under 20 students is 67%. So it's, you know, great. And I personally love that. That's another reason why I chose Felician, because I wanted to be in a setting where I'm not just a number and I could be personal with the professor and talk to them if there's a problem or anything, you know?
So true.
But it looks like we're running out of time, but thank you everyone so much for tuning into Spill the Tea. And thank you, Sister Annelle, for coming on today. It was amazing to have you.
It was wonderful to be with you people today.
So we hope you all enjoyed the show. Make sure to give us a follow on Instagram, and we can't wait for you to come back and tune in again next week.